finding out what it is I don't know. I'm definitely in that phase of learning about what I do, but I know so little. I am actually vice president for the British Isles of CECOP.
Right.
But CECOP hasn't told me yet what the British Isles is. So possibly I represent the Faroes or possibly Rockall, but I don't think they have, worked for our federation there yet, so I can't represent. Nick says that I've started co-ops. I have never started a co-op, and that's one gap. Unless this project here counts as starting a co-op, it may or may not be a co-op, and I did start this one. And probably at the end of my talk, I'll talk a bit about, in terms of personal reflection and learning, what I've learned from starting something and being a founder, and the problem of the founder, because it's a problem. You still need them. So this is a talk about or around something called the Worker Cooperative Solidarity Fund, or Solid Fund for short, which is a small project that started a little under 4 years ago. I've subtitled it Crowdsourcing Meets Co-op Development, because those are the two broad, that's what it's about. Crowdsourcing as in it's a project that not only brings together people's money, but also a project that brings together the wisdom of crowds to deliver what we want to do with that money. And that is to develop a stronger, larger, more autonomous movement of worker cooperatives in the UK, but it's not of the UK, it's not restricted to the UK. So I'm going to tell you a story about what this is and run through it. I have a few slides which are mainly just to keep you entertained. They're not a transcription of what I'm going to talk about. So I'm going to describe this project, and then I'm going to reflect, as this is a learning conference, what we can learn from it in a number of different aspects, using some five lenses, which I've borrowed from somebody called Henry Ginsberg, reflecting on the question of organisation, the question of context, reflecting on change, reflecting on relationships, and personal reflection. So that's how I'm going to structure how I propose to talk about the learning aspects of it. But as Nick says, my whole working life has been pretty much in work cooperatives. When I came to London at the age of 19, a sort of bright-eyed anarchist who'd seen some very interesting anarchists in London and thought I'd hang out with them, I also had to think about what I wanted to do for a living. And I decided to be a printer, which was a very honourable thing for an anarchist to be. There's a long tradition of anarchist printers, particularly in Switzerland. It's also a very well-paid trade back in those days. It isn't anymore, it's terrible now, but it was good money. But also it was a way for me to be able to to develop a skill that I could put to the service of the movement. And inevitably that meant joining a workers' cooperative. And in those days I didn't really think anything about workers' cooperatives, it's just what you did. So I'm talking about a period in the late 1970s to the early 1980s, when there was an enormous, there was a rich community of cooperatives and collectives working in communications in London, which was the city I chose to come to. Poster making collectives, typesetting collectives, printing cooperatives, community print shops, all of which used, to some extent, cooperative organising principles, whether they were explicit or not. There were probably 10 or 12 worker cooperatives, explicit worker cooperatives. Some of the collectives were attached to political groups. Some were community print shops where they were teaching people to develop their own skills in how to make a newspaper, how to do poster making. Some of them were service print shops of worker cooperatives providing the service for sale to earn their living. And I started out working in a place called Little A Printers, which was a community print shop in Wapping. That burned down in 1981. And I'd heard about a company called Calvert's, which is one of the more advanced ones. And I've worked for this worker cooperative called Calvert's from 1984, and I still work for them. So I worked there for more than 35 want, and then came back 3 months later because although I was earning a lot more money, it was making me utterly miserable. And another time I got fed up with them and tried to get a, went for a job in a publishing company as a line manager in a company that specialises in selling books to expatriates. And sailed through, I got to the last two, and then the managing director said, I knew that I was going to be managing somebody who was just out of school, who was going to be my underling. My final interview was with the managing director, and he only had one question for me. I thought I was going to sell this one as well. He had one question for me. He said, tell me about your experience of line management. So I said, what's line management? So I've never had a boss, right? I've turned 60 this year, I've never had a boss. I've done a lot of different jobs in my work at Co-op. I was a machine minder for 5 or 6 years. Then I was part of the bad crew in the Co-op that nearly brought it down, messing around with too much politics and too little work. But the entire front office resigned one day. We were doing record turnover and making record losses because every time we had a problem, we just employed another person. That didn't really work out. So then I had to then we had to work out how to run this business rather than just having fun in it and playing. So I was on machines in the morning and estimating in the afternoon, and then I was a production manager, then I was, you know, we certainly rotated jobs during that critical period. And somehow I ended up in sales and marketing. So since about 94 I've been selling, marketing my co-op, and then around 2000 I thought, why don't we do any business with these co-ops? So really all this time I've never really thought about being in a work co-op. I was just in one. It was just what you did, you know, it was kind of normal. I just sort of went, yeah, co-op, schmo-op, you know, the horrible capitalist enterprises, self-exploitation. But then I realised that I'd been working in this thing and had not managed to escape it. And I thought, there must be more to it than this. Also, I need to get business from somewhere. So I went to a cooperative conference. I went to a cooperative congress in Belfast in 2002 or 3 with my stall, trying to get business. And very quickly got sucked into, discovered these amazing people. Some extraordinary people. The conversations I had took me back to my heart in some ways, in terms of the stuff I believed in, but cooperators from many different backgrounds. And then, as does happen, if you turn up and look like quite bright-eyed, you get recruited onto some committee or other. So I joined the Worker Cooperative Council in 2004, then the board of Cooperatives UK in 2005, and I've been on the board of Industrial Common Ownership Finance, and I'm on the board of Cooperatives London, and the board of London Cooperative Development, and now I'm retreating from all these boards because I've kind of done that, and I'm going back to grassroots work for co-op development. So somewhere along this line, people started coming to me saying, we really like the look of your co-op, how do we do that? And I've been having conversations with groups, particularly in London but elsewhere, and discovered that I was becoming a barefoot cooperative development advisor. And then I got the opportunity to earn money doing that through something called the Cooperative Enterprise Hub, which is a scheme funded by the cooperative pay for people who have qualifications to go and advise, support, mentor individuals and groups who are setting up co-ops. And this is my speciality. And it turned out that I qualified to be a cooperative business advisor because I ticked 2 out of 3 boxes, and you had to have 2 out of 3. You either had to have an MBQ level 5 in business management or social enterprise or something. You had to have had a senior management role in a co-op, and or to have already advised 2 cooperatives or more, and I ticked 2 of those boxes, and therefore got under the wire when some much better people than me didn't, like David Boyle, who used to share. Anyway, that's a long story. The Worker Cooperative Council. So the story of the Worker of Solid Fund comes out of the sort of the context of what's been happening with our worker co-ops in the UK over the last 20 years. I'll go on to the next slide. The reason I put this up is because it's one of my favourite things. It's just something that Calvert's did as a t-shirt on co-op, graphic designers and printers. Corporate or die, it's a meme. sometimes how you communicate the necessity for cooperation is not straightforward. But even the co-operative group decided to steal this and put it on their t-shirts, which is pretty amazing. And the other reason I'm putting it up there is because in some ways the work of Co-op Solidarity Fund started out as a meme, just a kind of an idea, a hook. But what it actually is, in short, it's a grassroots project to create and deploy a permanent common fund paid for by voluntary subscriptions of worker co-op members, supportive organisations and other individuals. Been in operation since October 2014, since when we have had 585 people in total paying in small amounts of money, and we've collected more than £100,000. This isn't from co-ops, it's from individual cooperators, and specifically mainly individual worker cooperators. Now that may seem, I say this is a small project. It's a small project in the sense that £102,000, it works out around, we've collected roughly 30, at the moment we're collecting around £30,000 a year, which is £30,000 more than anybody else in the co-op movement is collecting to do this kind of work from our own resources. But it's still a small amount of money in the sense that it represents a quarter of the salary that you need to pay a chief executive of Co-operative UK. It would pay for between 40 and 60 days of consultant time on the day rate of a senior co-operative development worker. So it's kind of small potatoes in some ways. It's big potatoes in other ways because the worker co-ops in the UK that are members of Co-operative UK, and that's about, we think there are probably 400-ish worker co-ops in the UK, but only about 120 of them are actually members of Co-operative UK. And their contribution to the budget of Co-operative UK is about £30,000 a year. So it's big potatoes in the sense that our worker co-ops are actually, our worker co-operators are stumping up the equivalent of what they're paying to our APEX organisation. It's not nearly as big as I would like it to be. And my next question is, how many people here are members of the Worker Co-operative Solidarity Fund? That's read three. That's read. You just left, Rory.
Well, we're still joining again.
Oh, are you? Well, that's really good news. There's three of you. There's three of you, which means that I've got at least another 60 people to recruit. which is my intention. The fund currently has 561 members, and we're producing an income of around £30,000 a year. So what happened in 2014 was that there was the first actual gathering of worker cooperatives in their own conference gathering for nearly 15 years, because worker co-ops in the UK did have their own independent APEX organisation called the Industrial Common Ownership Movement, which included amazing firms like Scott Barda and people like that. And that came about through the rise of worker co-ops in the 1970s and the 1980s. And in the UK, that was the rediscovery by people on the left of common ownership and the 1975 Industrial Common Ownership Act, which provided a pathway for people doing projects like the ones I was involved in, to use common ownership as a principle in their worker cooperatives. So there was this rediscovery of worker cooperation that went along with the rise of political currents and movements through the early to mid and late 1970s and 1980s. And I'm talking about everything from the rise of the New Left and libertarian socialism, feminism, what was called the ecology movement was a big impetus, the gay rights movement, and the anti-racist movement. And all these political currents that were growing and getting stronger were looking for expression, and were looking for ways to do the things that they wanted to do, and they used worker cooperatives. Rather blunt description, but they used worker cooperatives as a vehicle for doing it without really thinking about it, because how else, if you were of that political ilk, would you there was a big rise. There were maybe 3,000 or 4,000 work properties in the UK by the early 80s. And that figure, you know, that figure started to decline almost as soon as Margaret Thatcher came into power, but it's not Margaret Thatcher's fault. By the end of the 1990s, worker co-ops were in a not good state and unable to support their own organisation. So the workers at ICOM, the Industrial Common Ownership Movement, merged with the consumer co-op apex organisation called the Cooperative Union to form a new body called Co-operative UK, whose primary members were then consumer co-operatives are big, in those days they were still rich, consumer co-ops, and then are dozens and dozens and dozens of mainly small worker co-operatives. And somehow the idea was, and the co-op union was in a bit of a state as well, somehow this influx of new young people, and the best kept secret was that by 2000 we weren't so young anymore, but we looked young we're going to kind of somehow sort each other out. And they created a body, so there are all the other sectors, housing, finance, the credit union movement, the agricultural co-ops, have their own apex organisations which are affiliated, most of them, to Co-operative UK, but we were direct members. And we have our own council called the Worker Co-op Council. But things were in poor state. So it took us 15 years to actually have a Worker Co-op conference. And that happened in 2014. It was called the Worker Co-operative Weekend, and it was a massive celebration. 70 or 80 people came together. We ran the whole weekend, 3-day, including food and accommodation, for £60 a head, and it broke even. That's because we cooked our own food. We camped. And at the end of that event in 2014, we were all very, it was a Sunday morning, we were very tired, and we were having a kind of plenary which we ran as an open space session, just chuck up lots of ideas about what we should do. And there's a lot of euphoria, as there tends to be at these things, you know, tired, euphoric. And one thing we agreed was that we have to do this again, but we need to be able to de-risk it. We need to make absolutely sure that we can keep meeting like this and learning from each other, because these events are co-learning events. That's how they run, that's how they roll. So we thought, well, how can we do it? And we won't do it by going to, we decided not to go to co-ops and ask them for money. What we'd do is we'd say £1 a week from individual worker co-operators who think this sort of thing should happen. And that went up there, and everybody just went, great idea. So it was a meme, a bit like co-operator or die. I think the hook was £1 a week. Not £52 a year or X amount of quarters, £1 a week. So a bit like a kind of union or association subscription, and very much individuals and not institutions. And essentially, over the next few weeks, I wrote a governing document, one side of A4, and it hasn't changed since then. They haven't even changed a single word of it. I wrote these purposes, and I think you'll agree that they look like they're really, really meaningful, but actually you can do almost anything you want within those purposes. They're very, very incredibly flexible. I also included in this all sorts of trigger words like solidarity. The word solidarity was definitely going to be in the name of this thing, because solidarity was something that people were starting to, was a cooperative value that people were starting to reinterrogate and look at around that time. And the idea of the fund was that it was a self-help and a mutual aid fund. It's not a grant fund, it's not a charity, it's not a trading business. And I'm not even sure if it's a cooperative, because somehow or other we decided that anybody who pays into the fund is a member. So there's no voluntary membership, and it doesn't trade, and it's not incorporated either. We haven't incorporated anything around it. So by October we were collecting money. We used a mechanism called Go Cardless. We persuaded Cooperative and Community Finance to hold our money for us in a commingled account, which they still did, and now they charge us for it. But the other thing was that we wanted to finance training and education programs. So that, you know, we had done some initiatives that Co-operative UK supported. All of this Co-operative UK did support, by the way. which was really important for us because it gave us a tiny little bit of John Atherton on the staff member's time to do some admin. I'm the other main administrator on it. But also, you know, Bob Cannell went to a co-op congress and said, in Birmingham when we were asked to put our hands in the air for one of three propositions, and the top three would go through. And Bob Cannell stood up and said, "I want to tell you about the Work Co-op Solidarity Fund," and everybody went brilliant, and it got, you know. And it was really important because although we talk about it guarantees the continuity of work with cooperative culture and organisation and autonomy, strength, self-reliance and autonomy of work cooperatives, under previous regimes at Cooperatives UK would have been stamped on as a threat to Cooperatives UK. In the new regime it isn't perceived that way, and it's correctly not perceived that way. So really important. So the purpose was to de-risk worker co-op events and education initiatives. So a lot, you see this word under right. We didn't necessarily just want to pay everything. What we wanted to do was make sure that people who put together training programs or events or conferences and were taking risk on breaking even could be assured by the fund that they wouldn't lose money. And that's one of the things, is we knew it wasn't going to be a lot of money, so we can't just go around paying for everything. But what we can do is kind of assure it. And actually, that was really important to some of the early stuff. But there were debates about its practical purpose, because these purposes are quite open. And obviously, what happens is that people pile in, and they think they know what it's really for. Right? So when people started putting forward proposals, I'll talk about the governance aspects, actually, because what we decided to do was use a technology that the co-op movement hadn't really used before in the UK, and it's a platform that was designed and built by a worker cooperative in New Zealand called the Lumio Collective, and it's called Lumio. And it's an online space for discussion, debate, making proposals and making decisions among groups of people who are physically dispersed. And I'll show you a few Lumio screens, but that is essentially where Solid Fund makes all its decisions. And what happened, and the way it works is that members put forward proposals for things that they think we should be funding, and then we discuss it, and then we have a vote on it. And it's sort of consensus based. It's important to know that the membership and contributions are registered on an individual basis. Every member has one vote. Members, when they join, are asked to tick a box saying that they support the aims and that they will work and participate in a cooperative spirit, including working with the people who do the administration, which is all done by volunteers. And it's been a fairly reasonable way of doing it. It's actually worked quite well. But I have to say, we now have 571 members. 576, I say we've collected over £100,000. That's the balance at the moment because the difference is what's gone out of the funds. Of those 576 people who joined, probably only about 155 of them actually participate. They're actually registered in our Lumio group, which is a closed group. So you can say that somewhat less than a third of the members are actually, in effect, active members. And there are reasons for that I quite like to reflect on. Part of the reason also, possibly, is that although I said we register people on an individual basis, in fact what happened was that people went away from the work of co-op weekend, went back into their work of co-ops, and said, we should all join this together. And that happened at all our largest work of co-op, happened at Suma at the Whole Food Conference, Suma, Essential Whole Foods, Infinity Foods, right down to Agile Collective, Calibus, all went back and essentially had general meetings where we agreed, understanding that it was on an individual basis, that we would all join the solidarity funds. And in some cases, it's done through payroll deduction, and in some cases, it's a straight donation. barriers to democracy. Since that sort of mass enrolment, that mass early enrolment, which happened quite quickly, the numbers are still going up, people are still enrolling, and now the majority of people who are joining are not members of worker co-ops, they're people who support industrial democracy and want to participate in it, want to see us thrive. And that's why I think there's actually a whole lot of space for this to grow, because we haven't really done any marketing at all. We haven't had the capacity to do it. Partly this has been action learning, because we have no idea what to do. John Atherton, who's my sort of co-admin, said he thought we'd probably gather a couple of grand, enough to sort of underwrite next year's work car weekend. He had no idea, and I don't think I did. I just thought it was a good idea. And so it's just, you know, part of it is trying to reflect on why has this worked when so many other initiatives haven't, and how do we make it work better, and could it be replicated? And I'll talk about that a bit later. So, you know, it's low cost, it's very lean, it's voluntaristic in character, it's maximalist in terms of participation. Of the 155 or 160 people who come into our Limeo group, I reckon probably 60 of them from time to time come into either discussions or exercise their voting right. So every proposition is discussed, every proposition results in a proposal, it's crafted through discussion, it is voted on, and I'll show you some slides of what that looks like. And you know, whoever actually turns up to vote, they're the board. And so you could say, well, we're not doing very well, and some people do moan, why is participation so low? I actually think it's quite high, considering all those factors. And I think actually having a board of 40 people, which is whoever turns up, is not a bad way of running a thing like this. But we do consider the sort of, there are potential issues and there are potential threats to doing it this way. But we do know that in addition to meeting on Lumio, we do need to meet in other spaces as well. You can't just do something like this. And we do have face-to-face meetings. We have, you know, usually piggybacking on some other gathering like a co-op congress or actually a worker co-op weekend. It's just get anybody to debate and kind of go deep into what we need to do strategically, knowing that we then have to take whatever we think, and we have to publish it, we have to get other people to come in. So you cannot run a democratic organisation entirely through electronic means. This is quite well known. You probably need other channels as well. So the way it works in terms of how we distribute is that proposals come from fund members. So there's no mechanism for people to apply to the funds. So, you know, we have had some misunderstanding. People have emailed us going, how do I apply to the Worker Co-op Solidarity Fund to get Worker Co-op Solidarity Fund to support this project? I've just had such a request from a co-op development agency in Gloucestershire that wants to help, you know, just some tiny C-Corp funding for a Worker Co-op startup in their neighbourhood. And I'd say, well, the way you do it is you either find a Worker Solidarity Fund member to be an advocate for you and to make that proposition, but actually even better, you just join it, and then you can make a proposal. And one of the assumptions is, the working assumptions is, that anybody who benefits from a, you know, some kind of material input from the Worker Co-op Solidarity Fund then joins. It's not compulsory. It is voluntary in that sense. But there's a kind of expectation, and that's how we see it growing. Is that people who benefit from it then join it. If anybody's interested in the sort of technicalities of how we run it whilst being an unincorporated association and why, I'd be happy to discuss some of those things. So, I think it's important that we've attracted support from individuals who are not worker co-operators themselves. I think this is always, you know, there's been goodwill towards around industrial democracy for a long time in this country, and community and cooperative finance, which used to be called industrial common ownership finance, was supported by people from right across the movement. It didn't just come you know, we're quite conscious that rapid growth in member numbers and finances could place stresses on this project in terms of its communication culture and decision making. And there are sort of a number of different scenarios for how it could play out. It could just carry on growing gently. It could just carry on. You know, if it ain't broke, don't fix it principle. We've had sort of slightly panicking, so we need to do some publicity on this, or we need to go and recruit individual donors, or we need to get people to put us in their requests. We need to do some proper marketing. The logo was done very quickly, it needs redoing. But actually, we haven't done that partly because we don't really have the resources to do it, but also because it seems to be working without doing anything like that. And there was somebody called Graham Mitchell who said, if it ain't broke, don't fix it, just let it grow gently. But it could grow quickly, because if instead of 576 we had 2,000 people contributing, which is not unreasonable, our income would be 100,000 a year, and then it starts to get kind of interesting. The one thing we haven't had is any large bequests or legacies or large just donations. We have had some. The Solidarity Economy Association just gave us £2,000 quite early on because they just saw it as a project that they wanted to support. I was running an Is a Co-op Right for You day in London, and I put some Solidarity Fund leaflets at the back of the room, and somebody came up to me at the end of it and she said, "I've got £1 million. I think I want to give it to you." and it was somebody who'd come into a lot of money as a request, and she wanted to do something good with it, and she liked cooperatives, she liked the idea of cooperatives, and she'd come to this day. And I said, let's talk further. And we did talk further, and John Atherton talked to her further, who's my, he's the membership officer of Co-op UK, who also gets some time to work on this with me. Her accountant advised her not just to give it away. They said, invest it beneficially, but don't just give it away. So that £1 million actually went to buy the entire £1 million share issue of Community and Cooperative Finance last year. So they have a 10-year share issue for their revolving loan fund for worker and community and other co-ops. And she just bought the whole share issue. I mean, she could have given us £50,000, that would have been amazing. Or John could have chipped a bit off, so I'll never forgive him. But actually, if somebody had just put £1 million into the World Cop Solidarity Fund, it would have blown us up. It would have just, it would have gone completely. Why do we bother with this pound a week then? Might as well just take it. So, I know there are people out there with spare £1 million that nobody's really tapping into. And I hope another of them turns up again. So just to kind of summarise this description of the project bit. Can I look at my time here? Oh, I forgot to start my timer. key success factors, I think, we have an original, simple, clear and sector-specific proposition. So it's because it was worker co-ops, and by that I mean the UK's common ownership worker co-ops that come out of that tradition. So it's the older co-ops, but a lot of the new co-ops that are now being formed in technology industries who've come towards it, they're all coming into it. And that's a growth area, by the way. The printers and the designers are all going. Now we've got tech companies and web developers and hosting companies that are sick of the tech industry and want to do something good. And they believe in open source, and they believe in open source organising it, and they come to the cooperative model as a way of doing it. So a lot of my work as a co-op developer, probably more than half of it, is working with tech groups. It's fascinating. They're the new 5 minutes. I think started the really serious bit, which is here. Enthusiastic support from a core group of early adopters, individual rather than corporate contributions, simple clear subscription formula, support from the wider movement and Cooperatives UK while remaining arm's length, volunteer effort and low running costs, emphasis on self-help, mutual aid and givers gain, maximum transparency and participation in consensus decision making, good use of technology, Lumio, Go Cardless, etc. But the challenges for the present and the future are the reverse of that. The reliance on voluntary effort is a risk. The potential for greater complexity in the way people contribute. Co- coordinating and maintaining mutually beneficial relationships with other cooperative projects and organisations while remaining autonomous. Talk a bit more about that. Risks around competition and duplicated effort, over-reliance on third-party technology, maintaining and managing mass participation, members' unfamiliarity with discussion protocols and consensus culture, rapid growth leading to organisational stress. But this has already inspired a new project called Platform 6. So there are, it's actually been started by people who are members of Solid Fund who see this as a potential model for a wider kind of cooperative development and resourcing it from within the movement, rather than going to power to change or grant or government, lottery grant money, or blackmailing the cooperative bank to give us £1 million so that they can still call themselves a co-op. It's nice to have, but it's not really we don't think that's a really sustainable way of funding, resourcing the development of our own movement. So Platform 6 is more ambitious, but they are just going to nick this pound a week thing when they launch. They're going to start off with individual members, but then they are also much more ambitious in terms of they're going to build resource banks. They're going to actually do the fulfilment end of this as well. Actually, Solid Fund could do that. We just need to get bigger and better. There's also, I haven't even talked about the projects we funded, but here are some of them. Just a little sample. Supporting the development of AltGen to form young people's freelancers co-ops. Sending people to conferences. Sending Jonas Algers to the Platform Cooperativism Conference in New York, the very first one. And there was a huge row about people flying by plane. So you discover that our worker co-ops really don't like aviation. Supporting events like Co-op Camp, putting money into the worker co-op archive project. The Co-Tech Network, the Cooperative Technologists Network retreat, funding that. We gave £5,000 to a poor worker co-op in Belfast that was having to, it was a video co-op, but they were having to rent the video equipment. Didn't have any money, so they were renting cameras and film equipment. Big debates about whether to lend them money, give them money, or so. We just gave them money, so they could just go and buy the equipment. Sending people to conferences seems to have become a bit of a thing. I don't really like it. It's like it's not quite right. But I'm just one of those people with my own view about what it should or shouldn't be. And what's been really interesting is the sophistication about how people talk about what Solid Fund is for has come on leaps and bounds. You don't really hear that complaint. I didn't think it was for this. Everybody started to understand that it's all for all of it, and that's quite interesting. £7,000 on developing a new program to bring out new barefoot worker co-op development advisors. In other words, finding people who have been working in worker co-ops who want to go out and proselytize and help other groups without going through a formal qualification process. And that's the sort of flavour of it. I have five lenses through which I'm going to reflect on the things that one could learn from this in terms of the context and in terms of the change we want to make, and in terms of the relationships, the kind of relationships that we're building through doing this, and in terms of reflecting on the question of organisation. Because this has all been action learning. It's all been very kind of organisation workshop method. It's like the way you learn to organise is by organising. And I think there's been a lot of that learning going on. I could have talked another 40 minutes about that, but I'm not going to. The fifth one is reflecting self-critically on my involvement in it. And I do feel with Solid Fund that at last I started a co-op. Even if it isn't actually a co-op, it's a mutual fund, but there you go. It's the nearest thing I'll probably ever get to actually starting a co-op. But I will claim that when that sticky notice board went up in two, it was me that put that thing going, worker co-op solidarity fund, £1 a week. So I am the founder. And part of my reflection is on what it means. Not only am I the founder, but I'm also the administrator. Founderitis is an issue. Other people have different narratives about how this started, but don't feature me as heavily as I feature in it. And I think that's an important part of any kind of founder thing. The other thing that, as a worker co-op developer, I work with people who are converting worry about this family question, and we raise it early on. What is it that, you know, if you're converting your company, what actually do you want out of this, emotionally, in terms of public recognition, and materially? And actually, I find that the emotional part of it is often the strongest thing, because actually, when you created this entity that's a person, it's like they really are your child. You know, it's not that easy to transition on a personal level. But plenty of discussions with people about, okay, you put in sweat equity, you'll probably never get paid for this. But what would be enough for you in terms of whether, you know, do you want something you can put on your wall to say I am the founder? Do you want to be reassured that do you want training in how to give up power and give it away to other people? Or do you want £2,000? And if we give you those things, will you just stop talking about this founder nonsense? So I haven't quite got to that point. And I think on the programme it says I'm the founder, but a lot of the new young co-ops that I talk to are very keen on getting rid of this concept of founder. They're very keen on saying, we're just a bunch of people who got together to do something together. And yes, you know, yes, I did this bit. Yes, they did that bit. But it can be a barrier to, particularly in the world of common ownership,